There we go. Good to be in the house of the Lord. We'll turn it over to Jeff.
Good morning. It's turned on. Test. It is. Stop treating me like Ron. Okay. Good morning. Now they just treated me like Ron. Turn me off again. I saw that. I wanted to say something this morning. It's just been a thought that's on my mind, and I think this is the problem with having a backup for Ron that is also a preacher. I want to tell you a story about my brother. My brother John, I'm the youngest of four kids. My brother John, the oldest boy, when he used to attend school, he was not a good student. And he didn't really get noticed. And why I say all that is I have never had a problem getting noticed. It is what it is. But my brother would attend school, and they would call the house, and they would say to mom, they would say, "Hey, your son John skipped school today." And so then she'd confront him when he came home and said, "Hey, John, they said you weren't in school." And of course, what would John say? "Yes, I was. I was in class," and do that. So it led to a confrontation at the school between my mom and the teacher. And this was attendance or whatever was taken in homeroom in the first class for the day. And so went in and confronted him and said, "Hey, you're saying my son's not there. My son is saying that he's there." And she said, "Well, you know, I'm pretty sure that I've seen him in there. Let me try and get to it." And they discovered the root of the problem was this, that it wasn't the teacher that was taking the role. It was a student in class that was taking the role. And they didn't know who my brother was. And so they would mark him absent because they didn't know it because he was quiet and nobody knew who he was and they didn't say it. And I say all of that to say this. Hasn't the camp meeting been good? Hasn't it been good? And here's the thing. If you're like I am, I'm thankful that I've been here. And there's so many people that I've seen, and I'm thankful that I've seen you, and I hope you're thankful that you've seen me. But to be honest with you, it doesn't matter if you've seen me and if I've seen you. It matters if the one taking the role has been able to mark you as being present this week during the camp meeting. And so here's the glorious thing about it. We have the service now. We have a service tonight. You have the ability for your name to be marked on the roll. I'm not saying you got to stand up and testify. I'm not saying you got to shout and run the building. What I'm saying is when God says move, when he says announce yourself, then announce yourself. Maybe that's to pray. Maybe that's to pray for another. Maybe that's to go to another and say, "I've been praying for you." Make sure your name's taken. Class is almost over. Make sure he calls your name on the roll. Page 88, I'm going that way.
Saying
Watching to see if there was an opening, and he sprinted down here to fill a spot. Let me tell you something, that's our church people. That's our church people. And you train them when they're young to sprint and fill a role. And I hope you've been blessed this week by our people who have been servants all week and allowed it. Some of them have not even been in one service. Because early this week, we had one of them, I think it was Nelson, show up with an apron on because he was working in the cafeteria. I appreciate our people. Amen. I appreciate our young people filling in. Les, pray for us. All the offering this morning goes to Brother Patrick Odell. We love him. Appreciate him. So everything you give this morning goes to him. good to be in the house of the Lord again. It's hard to believe it's already Thursday, and that's something. Time flies. So good to have the Parson family with us. We love them, appreciate them. I'll ask them to come at this time. They're going to sing for us, and then when they're finished, Brother Jacob's going to come on up and preach. Give them all a hand as they come this morning. Oh. Brother Patrick is going to...
What a wonderful week we have had, amen. So very grateful to be here. You all know us, and we're so just honored to be here and be a part of this. This is our 15th year coming, and I've heard some of you. I know Tammy was saying the other day it was 25 years, I believe, and I thought, why in the world didn't you tell me about this sooner? I'm sure she did. this is Miss Avery. We were not even, she wasn't even here the first time we were. This church was such a healing place for me. My very first time here, the day before I came, I miscarried a baby. And I had to come and get repaired. I was broken. And every single year, I think about just how it... Brother, we talked about it, how that they love on you and how sweet and how kind that you guys were to us. And so before I become a mess and start crying harder and can't sing, I'm going to let Avery come and sing for you today. She's got a couple of songs she's been singing. Aunt Tammy's asked her for one. And so look how big she's getting. Can you believe this? And I wore the highest heels that I could find in my closet. It's not helping. You bless them today, all right? Amen.
Lost yourself.
Let the little children come to me. And so she ran to Jesus, and quietly she sat upon his knees. And she felt so safe as she looked into his eyes. But suddenly something happened. As she looked down, she started to cry. She looked at the size of a scar buried deep into his flesh. You could see concern in her face as she looked up to Jesus and she said, but she just could not go away. She ran up to Jesus and he heard her say,
what happened to your hands? Did it make you cry? Did it hurt a
feeling good one night, and she said, I think I can do it, and she's had it ever since. What would it be today if we didn't come up here and sing a song from another great writer? That one my sister Tammy wrote, but we can't help but ever since we started coming, we fell in love with Hoy Duncan's writing, and we just can't stand on this stage without showing our appreciation, how much we love him, and If you're watching, thank you so much for allowing us to sing your songs. I can't thank him enough. And this one just says, Lord, I thank you.
Lord, I just want to thank you for all the blessings you have poured so bountifully on me. And Lord, you heard my feeble cry. You gave me back my life. Lord, I am so unworthy.
Who worshiped at your feet. Yes, my Lord, there's something I've got to say to you. So I'll say,
Lord, I just want to thank you for all the blessings you have poured so bountifully on me.
Isn't he a good God?
Yes, to me,
Lord. Been so good,
right?
this morning. I can't tell you how good he's been to me. I'm thankful. Brother Jeff, when you were talking about the school this morning and how maybe somebody's tucked away and they seem unnoticed, but I'm glad that the one who's important, the one who knows everybody in there, doesn't miss one. And that even if we're tucked away somewhere, and sometimes I feel about this big in this room, but I'm so thankful that the only one who matters sees me. And he sees you this morning, and I know that he knows you're here. He knows why you're here. He knows what you need. And this morning he has been so very good to me, and I'm here to give him the glory for who he is, for everything he's done. I love him this morning. I grew up in this room. I was 13 years old the first time we got to come, and many of my heroes, I know you hear it over and over again, but really, many of my heroes have walked into and out of this room so many times. And I'm so excited to see Miss Susie walk in or come in the other day. Thank you to everyone who worked so hard to make that possible. Such an encouragement, I know, to her and to us. But I walked over to her, I got the chance to hug her and say, because you stand for Christ, you've shown me how, and you've shown me that I can make it. If you can do it, I can too. Giving flowers while we're here, telling people how much you love them, how much they've encouraged you and helped you in your walk with the Lord. I have a few that I can't tell right now that have poured into my life, have made an impact, and I'm so thankful. But they're on the other side, and they're waiting. That cloud of witnesses, they've already joined. And not only are they cheering us on and encouraging us to make it, but how much more, I sure believe how much more that Jesus is calling for us, encouraging us, and telling us that we can make it, because there is a place. This is the shadow, and there is a place beyond this. And I'm so thankful this morning that there is another side, and that this isn't all there is. But when you get discouraged and you feel all alone, please remember that there's not only the encouragers that'll surround you here, but there are voices on the other side calling for you to make it. There are prayers that have been prayed long, long ago that God is still working through, that are helping you along, and that are encouraging you today. This is called Voices from the Other Side.
Hi, my lovely family. I hope you're having a good day today.
Love you guys so much. I will talk to you soon.
Still have the message from the last time that you called. I wish I hadn't been so busy, we could have talked about it all. And when there's no one else around, I sit and listen to the sound of your voice. You always had a way of saying what I need to hear. Somehow you make that heavy on my shoulders disappear. And I'm trying to carry through in a world without you. It ain't easy. Oh, but they say there's a cloud of witnesses cheering everybody on. And in that choir of saints, I know that you're the loudest one. Shouting, keep your eyes on Jesus, whatever you do. Don't you dare give up the fight. Yeah, these days that's what I hear when I hear voices from the other side. Seems like I'm at a crossroad almost every other day. And standing there, I find myself just wondering what you say. And when I'm tempted just to quit, feel like giving in, and I remember, oh, that they say there's a cloud of witnesses cheering everybody on, and in that choir of saints I know that you're the loudest one. You're shouting, keep your eyes on Jesus, whatever you do. Don't you dare give up the fight. Yeah, these days that's what I hear when I hear voices from the other side. When I close my eyes, I can see you standing with the angels and the saints. I can hear you telling me, oh, you just wait. Yeah, because there really is a heaven, and the streets are paved with gold. Sorrow, no more pain. Oh, and there ain't a single tear in sight. Yeah, these days that's what I hear when I hear voices. I know someday we'll be together just rejoicing on the other with gold. There really is a Savior. He's really on the throne. There'll be no more separation, no more sorrow, no more pain. And there ain't a single tear inside. Yeah, these days, that's what I hear when I hear voices. I know someday we'll be together just rejoicing on the other side. Can I see a wave of hands if you're going with me?
Just praise the Lord, you're free at last. I don't know whether to shout or cry. I believe I'll do a lot of both, amen. Boy, God has been so good. What a song. They just sung my song right there, amen. I thank God for that. He never once gave up on me. I'm so thankful this morning that I've been saved, amen. That I know down in my heart, without a shadow of a doubt, that I've been born again, washed in the blood of Jesus. I knew who I was before. Praise God, He made an evident change in me. I'm nothing here today. I know who I am. I know who I was. I know who I'd be without God. But He's everything. I want to give every bit of the praise, honor, and glory here today from anything that I say or do to the Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. I thank Him for saving my soul. October of 2009, I was lost and on my way to hell. I'm not proud of it. I was addicted to methamphetamine. I'd been on drugs and alcohol for around 13 years. My heart and life was full of bitterness, full of anger, full of hate. I was as hateful a person as you'd ever be around. I hated life. I hated living. I hated myself. But that day in October 2009, down on my knees, in a puddle of tears and snot, my living room floor, I'm telling you, praise God, I met Jesus, amen. He saved my soul, and I've never been the same ever since, and I praise Him for that. It's been 13 years, and I give God the glory, because I couldn't do it. I couldn't quit those drugs. I couldn't take that bitterness and unforgiveness and hatred out of my heart, but He did, amen. And it's been 13 years, not one drop of alcohol, not one drug in my body, and I give Him the praise, amen, and I don't ever want to quit praising Him for that. I got to testify before I preach. I just got to tell how good He's been to me, amen. I want to thank God for this camp meeting. I want to thank God for Brother Will. These wonderful people. I don't want to start calling out names and I'd miss anybody, but since they're all so important to me. It's been probably 10 years ago. I want to thank God for Pastor Chris Rumfeld. I've never been a member of his flock, but I call him Pastor. I went to hear him sing one night at Beaver Creek Free Will Baptist Church. I didn't know him much then. Hadn't been saved long. Hadn't been preaching long. We had a good meeting that night. He come up to me afterwards and he said, "I want you to go to Florida with me next week." I was still working a job back then and hadn't went full time in the ministry yet. And I knew I had to work and other things. And I said, I don't think I can. But in the back of my mind, it wasn't so much work. It was, I don't know nobody down there. Barely know you, and you want me to go to Florida with you for a week? And he was persistent about it. "Brother Patrick, I believe you need to go to Florida with me." And he called in a few days, "Are you going to Florida with me?" I said, "Yeah, I've been praying. I'll go."
Yeah, thank you, Lord.
I didn't know Roger Duncan. I didn't know Diane. I didn't know anybody, but they took me into their home. Felt just as home there as anywhere I've ever been. And all of you people, for these 10 years now, I had to miss one year out of 10 years. I've been here, and it's been so good. This meeting starts my year off right. And I just wrote this down, and I want to say this before I read the scripture. This week, I've got my honey. This week, I've got my oil. This week, I've learned how to be in 2023. This week, I've been reminded If we want to block out the noise of the enemy, we need to make some noise ourselves. This week I've been reminded of what a haven that this place has been to me. But more so, I was reminded because I've been to a haven that when I get back home, I need to be a haven to somebody else. And this week my passion has been revived. I thank God for camp meeting. I mean this from the bottom of my heart. I love you all, and that's God. We know we pass from death unto life because we love our brethren. You're looking at a man that was hateful and full of hate. There's no way I would have told you that I loved you. There's no way that I would have hugged a grown man's neck and said, I love you, brother. There's no way. But God done that. Love you, Chris. Thank you, brother. Thank you. Whew. Oh, God's been so good. I promise you, I had not read Scotty's notes. I hadn't even had the last page yet. Me and him hadn't discussed his lesson this morning, but if you paid any attention at all, you're about to say, that's God. I want you to turn with me to 2 Corinthians chapter 12, and I will say that for a couple weeks I had a message that I felt like I would preach here this morning, and it's been burning in my heart, a fresh message, and wouldn't even preach it at the church Sunday morning. God wouldn't let me. I felt like that I would be preaching this message down here this week, but God has led me away from that. I've prayed and I've sought the Lord and I begged God and I believe with all my heart for some reason unknown to me that this is where God has me this morning. So I ask you to please pay attention to the message, to the voice of God today, and listen, because I believe that God has some help for some people here this morning. 2 Corinthians chapter number 12. I'm going to start reading in verse number 7, but we know in verses 1 through 6 that Paul tells these Corinthians about the vision that he had, about what took place in his life, about his personal encounter with this man named Jesus Christ. And he tells them about this. And this is a big thing in his life. Can you imagine seeing what Paul seen? Can you imagine being taught what Paul was taught? Can you imagine being the one born out of due time? The apostle Paul, the responsibility, can you imagine what was upon him? Great man of God. But I want you to listen to these verses, chapter 12, verse 7 down through 10. And we'll pray, and I ask you to please pray with us and pray for us. The Bible says this in verse number 7. He said, "And lest I should be exalted above measure through the abundance of the revelations, there was given to me a thorn in the flesh." Now, listen to this. I'm not going to focus as much as Scotty did on the thorn in the flesh. We'll make mention of it. But here's where I want to get to. And this is not my choice of messages to preach this morning. There's a lot of other things I would like to talk about. But thank God, God will let us get somewhere here in a little bit. But right now, this, what we're about to talk about, is not something that I like to really talk about this morning. But it's necessary. But the Bible said, Paul said, that the messenger of Satan to buffet me, lest I should be exalted above measure. For this thing I besought the Lord thrice, that it might depart from me. And he said unto me, my grace is sufficient for thee, for my strength is made perfect in weakness. Most gladly, therefore, will I rather glory in my infirmities, that the power of Christ may rest upon me. Therefore, I take pleasure in infirmities, in reproaches, in necessities, in persecutions, in distress, for Christ's sake, for when I am weak, then am I strong. I want to preach this morning, if God will be my helper, for a few moments of time on this thought, from the buffet to the buffet, amen. God help us, Father, as we bow before you, Lord, this morning. God, we come to you as humbly, Lord, as we know how. Thanking you, God, for another day, another opportunity to be in meeting this morning. God, we thank you for these folks, Lord. And God, we're not here to hurt them, but to help them. And God, we pray this morning, God, that through your Spirit, God, that you would open every heart and mind and make them receptive unto what thus saith the Lord. I pray, God, that you'd anoint us afresh and anew. These lips of clay, God, that they'd say and speak only that which you'd have me to say and nothing else. Lord, empty me out of every carnal thought, every selfish desire, God, anything that'd hinder your sweet Spirit in this place. Lord, I pray, God, that thy holy will be done. Lord, we love you, we thank you, and we praise you. And Father, we ask you all these things in Jesus' holy and precious name. Here this morning, I want to focus on this word buffet for just a few moments. This is a word in the English language. It can be pronounced two different ways and mean two totally different things. But here this morning, when you look at this word buffet, this is what this word means: a blow or a thump, a strike with a fist to the face, a slap, to beat in contention or to contend against, such as in boxing. This word actually means this morning to beat up. This word is used in Matthew chapter 26 and verse number 67. Speaking of Jesus, the Bible says, "Then did they spit in his face and buffeted him, and others smote him with the palms of their hands." Here this morning, I appreciate Scotty's message. I appreciate the way he looked at that thorn in the flesh. And I want to say this morning, for later on in the message, I'll come back to it. But a thorn in the flesh can be many different things. I know there's great arguments over what Paul's thorn in the flesh was. Some thinks this, some thinks that. I'm not going down that route this morning. I'm focusing on what God has in my mind and in my heart. But I want to say this, that this morning there could be many things that could be a thorn in the flesh to me and you. It's done been stated that a person could be a thorn in the flesh. I believe this morning, amen, that a place could be a thorn in the flesh. I believe this morning that a circumstance could be a thorn in the flesh. I believe this morning that a sickness could be a thorn in the flesh. I even believe this morning, and you'll understand this better here in just a little while, that a date can be a thorn in the flesh. And I don't mean that by boy and girl going out. I mean that by a calendar date, by a day and time in your life when something happened, and when that date rolls around, it's a thorn in the flesh to you. But right here, my friends, is what makes the difference this morning. Everybody here, I'm certain, has thorns in the flesh in their life. Everybody here has something that hinders them or hurts them in some kind of way. But I'm not focusing as much on that as what Paul said after this. He talked about the thorn in the flesh, and he said, "The messenger of Satan to buffet me." How many of you can acknowledge this morning that it's bad enough to have cancer? Oh, but when the messenger of Satan comes and he says you ain't going to make it, he says you ain't going to get no better, he says you'll never come out of this, and the messenger of Satan begins to talk to you and speak negative things into your life, and the messenger of Satan begins to bring doom and gloom down upon you, and the messenger of Satan begins to steal your joy and steal your peace and steal your hope. My friend, that is when we are being buffeted by Satan himself. That is when he is trying to rob us of everything that God has given us. Oh, but my friend,
here this morning. That's not God's will, amen. Hey, that we focus on these negative things. I want to look at a few things this morning. I'll try to hurry and be as quick as I can. The Bible tells us in the book of 1 Peter chapter 5 and verse number 8 that our adversary the devil walketh about seeking whom he may devour. He wants to try his best, amen, to affect us, to affect our Christianity, and to make us ineffective for God. He wants to try to steal our joy. He wants to try to steal our hope. He wants to try to steal our peace. And he uses his messengers to do this. They get inside of our mind and they begin to speak to us and they bring us down. Maybe nobody here knows what I'm talking about, but I personally, here about a month and a half ago, and this is where I don't like to give the devil a lot of credit, and if this wasn't a message, I wouldn't even be talking about it. But about a month and a half ago, I went through something, some opposition, and it was what it was. It's just one of those things that we face in life. Oh, but then, Brother Chris, the messenger of Satan came to me, and I spent some lonely days at my house. Oh, I'm telling you, with all these thoughts racing through my mind, him telling me this and telling me that, and him doing everything he could to get me down to the lowest place, amen, that I could be, and to make me ineffective for God. My friend, that's what he does. He likes to get inside our hearts and inside our heads and inside our thought process. He tries to bring as much negativity into our life as he can. Paul prayed about this thorn in the flesh, and I want to show you how important this is. Paul said, I prayed thrice, he said. Hey man, that may not mean nothing to you, but that means a lot to me. Paul was saying, I actually prayed about this thing 3 different times. That tells me most things he probably didn't have to pray but once, amen. He gave it to God and left it with him. Oh, but this thing bothered him so bad. This thing hurt him so bad. He had to deal with this thing continually, and it was always after him. It was never plumb go away, maybe get better for a little while, but always coming back. The messenger of Satan reminding him, oh my friend, listen this morning. He prayed, amen, and God didn't take it away. Why didn't God take it away? He explains to us in the scripture, it was so that he would not be exalted above measure. God actually allowed this to go on in his life. He actually allowed this to happen. Now this is hard to get a hold of sometimes. This is hard for us to want to accept and understand. But let us consider for a few moments, hey man, the servant Job. The Bible teaches us that Job was a righteous man. He was a good man. God actually spoke and said of Job that there's not another one like him on the earth. And God actually said unto Satan, have you considered my servant Job? Oh, and Satan began to talk about him. He said, oh, Job's just serving you because you take such good care of him. Oh, Job's just serving you because you've been so good to him. God said, I'll tell you what I'm going to do. I'm going to let you go down there and try old Job. I've got that much faith in him. I believe that much in him that you can do what you want to unto Job, and he's not going to quit serving me. Oh, I'm going to tell you how we've been through some things, but I don't believe anybody could stand up this morning and say I've been through more than Job. And one day, my friend, he lost everything that he had. Oh, listen, he lost his children. He lost all of his animals. He lost possessions and dwellings. I mean, if that wasn't good enough, Satan come back and he struck him down with boils. Now he's sick. Now he's got boils over his body. He's sitting there and there's one thing left in his life. It's a wife. And here she comes. And she said, Job, why don't you just curse God and die? Look at the shape you're in. Oh, he said, you talk like a foolish woman. Blessed be the name of the Lord. The Lord giveth and the Lord taketh away. Oh, I'll tell you, she was one of those messengers of Satan. And if that wasn't good enough, here came three friends, amen. And they were messengers of Satan. They didn't have encouraging words to Job. They didn't say, lean your head on my shoulder and cry. I'll pray with you and it's going to be all right. They said, boy, Job, you must have done something really bad. Boy, what are you hiding, Job? What do you got in the closet, Job? And they began to speak against him and just tell how sorry he must be and that God was dealing with him and judging him. But my friend, I want you to know this morning that was not the case at all. God had allowed this to come into his life. Paul said he was going through it so he wouldn't be exalted above measure. But I want to give you a few biblical examples here this morning of why me and you go through things. 1 Peter chapter 4, verse number 12, the Bible says this: Beloved, think it not strange concerning the fiery trial which is to try you, as though some strange thing happened unto you, but rejoice inasmuch as ye are partakers of Christ's sufferings. All me and you need to do, anytime something happens to us, and I'm not saying this is always easy, but we need to remember how that Christ suffered for us. We need to remember what He went through. We need to remember that and be reminded that we are not exempt from trials and from suffering in this life, but it's all for a reason. Any test or trial, I wrote this down, that God allows to come into our life is not meant for our destruction, but for our betterment. So many times we think, God's trying to kill me. God hates me. Is God angry at me? What have I done? I want to remind you of a scripture that I love so much. Romans 8 and 28. And we know, K-N-O-W, with authority, we know. Are you a child of God this morning? Are you saved? I don't know what you're going through, but He does. He knows. He cares. And we can know that all things work together for good to them that love God, to them who are called according to His purpose. If a refiner wants to get the pure gold, he's got to heat up the fire, Brother Kenny. And most of the time, the gold must be put through the process several times to get all the unwanted sediments out of it. But when that gold is pure and refined, it's as pure as transparent glass. You can see through it while it's in the fire. There's nothing left in it that's harmful or dirty or shouldn't be there. He's got that gold right to where He wants it to be. And so many times these processes go on in our life and it's so hard and so hurtful and so painful and there's tears involved. So many times we don't think we're going to make it. So many times we lose sight, we lose hope. The messenger of Satan has buffeted us so hard and beat us up so bad that we're at the point we're just about to give up. I love this verse that Job spoke in Job 23 and 10. But He knoweth the way that I take. Woo! When He hath tried me, I shall come forth as gold. Praise God. Hallelujah. Amen. Hang on this morning. Satan may be beating you up. You may be in the valley. You may be in trouble. You may be in trials. But there's a better day coming. Praise God. You may be in buffeted right now. But there's a buffet coming. Amen. I think about Joseph. What all he went through. Giving you a couple biblical examples, I'm moving on. Joseph. Probably the greatest Old Testament example of Christ that we have. Whew. Man, I love to study about Joseph. You know his life was rough. God was with him all the way. He was betrayed by his brothers. His own daddy wouldn't believe the dream that he shared with him. They all got jealous because his father favored him a little more. Gave him that precious coat of many colors. Bible teaches us that they threw him in a pit. They discussed killing him. One brother said, "Nah, let's not do that," and they sold him into slavery. He wound up in Egypt. He wound up in the house of the most wealthiest, most powerful person in Egypt. He went through things, I'm telling you. He wound up in prison. He was lied on, betrayed upon. But everywhere he was, in that pit, in that prison, everywhere he was, God had not forsaken him. God had not left him. God was still there. He may have got beat up physically. He may have got beat up by the devil. He may have got beat up emotionally and mentally. But God was still there, amen. And in the end, praise God, just like old Job, things was better than ever before. He wound up being in charge of everything, amen, there in Egypt. And do you realize that at the end of that story, that his own family, his own brothers, the one who betrayed him and sold him, they were coming to him for help. Listen to this. What that the devil and others might mean for us for evil, the Lord can make it good. Ain't that wonderful? That somebody can actually do something against you and mean to hurt you, but our God, the mighty God, the amazing God that we serve, can take that thing and turn that thing around, and He can make that for mine and your good? What a God! We should never doubt, we should never fear, we should never struggle, but we do. Paul did. I want you to think about this, and I'm trying to hurry. If we can look for the good in our trials and situations, I know sometimes it's hard, but that's exactly what Paul done. Paul said it was a thorn in his flesh, something that kept him, here's the key, humble. That I may not be exalted above me, it kept him humble. What he was going through, and I want to say this, I didn't realize it. I'm going to be honest. I'm a lot like somebody the other day said, the most honest preacher you'll ever know. I didn't realize it, Brother Chris. But when I went through what I went through about a month and a half ago, you know what? I had drifted away from God. I'm not saying I was out in sin. I'm not saying that. I hadn't quit praying, I hadn't quit studying, but probably wasn't like I ought to be. But I found out that I was not really, truly seeking God like I should have been. And I found out that when I went through what I went through, Will, you know what it done? It brought me back here. It brought me here. And these times that what we go through, it's not meant to destroy us, but to bring us closer to God. And if people would only understand and they would learn to use their situations. One of the saddest things I believe I see all the time is people that's been through stuff. It has a testimony and has a witness, and they don't use that to help others. I believe the things we've been through, I'll never get over Richard as long as I live. That message impacted me and changed my life. I'll never get over the first time I heard Jacob Berry preach. Brother Andy Hooper said, "I believe you need to go to Hayesville tonight." I said, "What for?" He said, "There's a young man preaching by the name of Jacob Berry. He said if you'll go listen to him, it'll change your life." I scoffed inside. I
said, change my life. He said, I really believe you should go here. He didn't tell me he was in a wheelchair. He didn't say nothing. He said, there's a young man preaching. Please go listen to him. Yeah. I remember that night, it was during the youth meeting. I remember that night, I was sitting about where they are. Hazel, he was right there. Cat done out of the bag. He's in a wheelchair. I seen that right off the bat. Yeah. I seen this breathing apparatus.
Yes, that's right.
And I watched his mother unhook that from his neck. Yes. And I watched a young man in a wheelchair. As I opened up my Bible and stood there that night, I noticed he didn't have a Bible. He said, turn to the book of Job, and I believe he quoted 11 verses. And as he did, my big hot wet tears fell upon my Bible. And I said, oh God, using your circumstances, your situation, what you've been through. Paul used his thorn in the flesh to help other people. He let it make him a better Christian. He didn't let it stop him. He knew God promised him that his grace would be sufficient to get him through. And I promise you here this morning, if you'll use your situations and let God work through you, it'll be amazing what God can do with the things you've been through. The greatest testimonies you'll ever share is God done this. God brought me out of this. God brought me through this. God healed me from this. Because there's somebody listening, somebody watching that needs to hear that. Now, I want to say this. Paul felt like this came upon him, keeping him from becoming prideful. He said, lest I should be exalted above measure. He knew that God's grace would be sufficient to get him through. Made up his mind that he was going to glory in his infirmities. We can easily be overwhelmed with the bad things that are going on in our lives and forget all about the good that God does for us each and every day. Here's the personal thing I want to share with you. I'm trying to hurry, but I ain't got to the good part yet, but I promise I'll be quick. I mentioned when I started about how dates can be a thorn in the flesh. I've got a date, Will, coming up here in about 2 weeks. May not mean a lot to you. That date's January the 26th. If my little girl was still alive, she'd be 14 years old, January the 26th. Last year, Chris would have been celebrating her 13th birthday. She'd have been a teenager. And every year, that messenger of Satan comes. If you'd have done this, if you wouldn't have done this. Well, he tries to beat me up. You wasn't a fit dad. You was on drugs. You was raised in church. If you'd have got saved when you was young. If you'd have lived for God, why didn't you do this? There's dates. And I think in my mind, I think, what would that little girl be? I don't know what she would have been, but I know what she is. Woo! She's in heaven! She's with Jesus! Her little 8-month-and-3-day-old body that struggled to breathe every breath it took, that was struck down with spinal muscular atrophy from birth,
her little body that never goes stronger but kept getting weaker, it's perfect now. Sometimes that messenger of Satan will get me focused on what I don't have. And I'll forget all about that little 19-year-old Chris that called me this morning on the way to church. Said, "Dad, I just wanted to call you. I'm walking to class." She got a tough schedule this year. But I told her, I said, "Honey, she's going to organic chemistry this morning." "What is that?" You know what I said? And Chris, you've helped me with this. I didn't want to be a messenger of Satan to her. She's discouraged. You know what I said? I said, "Honey, you can do it." I said, "Honey, you're smart, and I've watched you for years, and you apply yourself, and you put forth your best to everything you do." And I said, "Honey, I wished I'd have been more like you when I was your age." And I meant every word of that. I wasn't just saying it to ruffle her feathers. I meant that. But sometimes we can focus on what we've lost, on what we don't have, on what we've done wrong, on what we've messed up with, and we can neglect to look at and be thankful for all that we do have, what God has blessed us with, how good He's been to us. I'll remind you that whatever we might endure down here, it's only temporary. Paul said in Romans 8 and 18, "For I reckon," I think he is a country boy, don't you? "I'm just old hillbilly. I ain't ashamed of it. I am what I am by the grace of God." Paul said, "For I reckon that the sufferings of this present time are not worthy to be compared with the glory which shall be revealed in us." Psalms 30 and 5, "Weeping may endure for the night, oh, but joy cometh in the morning." Hey, listen, you may be under the buffet here today, but nah! Woo! There's a... Hallelujah! Woo! Glory to God! Praise God, we're going from the buffet to the buffet. And I want to say this. There's a buffet for us right now. Some Christians just think it's in the world to come, and boy, it's going to be great. But I can promise you, according to the Word of God, there's a buffet for me and you right now. And I've learned this, and they's wiser than me here this morning, more knowledgeable than me, been serving God longer than I have, but I've learned this most of the time. After the buffet comes the buffet. Whew. I've learned that. I love what David said. "The Lord is my shepherd. I shall not want. He maketh me to lie down in green pastures. He leadeth me beside the still waters. He restores my soul. He leadeth me in paths of righteousness for His name's sake. Yea, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil, for Thou art with me. Thy rod and thy staff, they comfort me." What did he say? "Prepare a table before me." Where at? "In the presence of mine enemies." Amen. "Thou anointest my head with oil. My cup runneth over." Praise God. He tells us right there in the Word of God that He will feed us and make our enemies watch us eat. Amen. Woo! Glory to God. Hallelujah. Ain't that good? Woo! What are we doing this morning? Amen. Does anybody else know what's waiting on them outside that door, those doors? A world that's full of sin, full of hatred, full of evil. But God, for for a little space of time, has let us come inside these walls in His house to be fed from His table. We are sitting at the table of God, feasting upon the goodness of God, and the enemy's out there, and he's just got to sit back and watch, amen. Praise God, hallelujah. Woo! I believe we got a buffet now, but I believe there's one to come. Revelation 19, verse 7 and 8. If you got Brother Will's book, I sat down the other night and I read chapter 6. Woo! The marriage supper of the Lamb. Praise God. You know, one day He's coming back after His bride. He's going to get us out of this old sin-cursed world. And according to the good word of God, He's going to take us, praise God, and feed us at a feast like we've never ate at before. Won't that be wonderful? Here's something I can't get a hold of, and I'm through. Whoever's singing the song of invitation, you come on. I feel like I've minded the Lord. Here's something I can't get a hold of. I really can't. Luke chapter 12, verse 37. The Bible says at that feast, He's going to take off His garment and gird Himself and serve me. A homeless, hopeless, helpless meth addict, an angry, bitter, unforgiven sinner, hateful, but saved to the uttermost. Yes. And you know what? In the eyes of God, when I got born again, done been said, wrote my name on a white stone. A new name. I ain't who I used to be. I ain't what I was. I'm a new creature in Christ Jesus. This flesh ain't going to heaven. Hope you understand that. Nothing that defileth shall enter therein. But I'm going to get a glorified body. Ooh, ain't it going to be good? Here this morning, you may be in the battle of your life. I don't know. You may have put on a face this morning and came to the house of God. There's somebody, I don't even remember who, they talked to me in the back. And they said, Patrick, you always seem like you're happy. They said, whether you are or not, I don't know. They said, but you sure seem that way. Not always happy, but I've always got something to be happy about. Yeah. You know, in my darkest day and darkest hour, I can thank God I'm not going to hell. Yeah. I can thank God my sins are washed away and under the blood, never more to be remembered. I can give Him praise. But maybe the battle this morning has stole your praise. Maybe you're being buffeted right now like never before. You're going through something and you don't understand it. The messenger of Satan is literally beating you up, taking your joy, taking your peace. The table is spreading. This morning, if you will, won't you come to the buffet where God's got all you want? Won't you come as they sing?
Pastures, He makes me lie down. restores my soul and he leads me on for his name, for his great name. Surely goodness, surely mercy, right beside me.
God used you today. You fed your people. You used you today. Appreciate that. How about the Parson family? Let's give them a hand. Wonderful job. I'm going to ask Patrick to make his way back to the vestibule. Make sure you get by and shake his hand. What a great, great job he did. Thank you for coming. We've got one more night tonight. And Brother Chris Rumfelt will be preaching. Looking forward to that. We're going to have the Duncan family sing for us this evening. So I want them to be ready to sing for us. Looking forward to that. Let's be dismissed in prayer. Thank you for being here. Ladies have lunch prepared over in the cafeteria. Amen. Brother Gary, would you dismiss us in prayer?